a time when a whole new recreating can happen, or alternately, a completely new form of total control will happen.
The Medicine Path podcast is an ongoing exploration into the intersections of spirituality, depth psychology, and psychedelics. The Medicine Path is a wholly independent and listener-supported project, so please consider becoming a supporter at patreon.com/medicinepath or by subscribing and leaving a review on iTunes. You can find out more information at medicinepathpodcast.com. Now, here's your host, Brian James.
Welcome to the Medicine Path Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Brian James. Well, friends, this episode is a really special one for a couple of reasons, at least. One of which is that it marks the fourth anniversary since the first podcast I recorded with one of the Gundecha brothers, an Indian singing guru that I was spending time with for a week and learning from back when we lived in Montreal for a couple of years. Now we're back on the West Coast, which feels like being back home. And since that time, I've recorded at least 88 podcasts. There have been a little extras here and there, but this is officially podcast episode 88. So the podcast hasn't been released as frequently as some other podcasts. And that's has a lot to do with just me following my curiosity and going with the flow and only doing podcasts when I feel inspired, and particularly with people who inspire me. Another reason why this podcast is really special is because of the guest. If you're a fan of Thomas More or James Hillman's work, then you're going to really love this conversation with Robert Sardello, who has been a colleague and friend of those two, and kind of came up in the same circles, but I think has a really unique and distinct approach. Robert wasn't someone that I had heard of until fairly recently. Thomas More, who I'm in a study group with, pointed me toward Robert's work, and as soon as I started diving into it, I found somebody who's definite spiritual elder. Robert has developed an approach to psychology that he calls integral spiritual psychology, and it has a really great emphasis on heart awareness and our relationship with the earth and the cosmos that deeply resonates with me. And this conversation with him is pure magic. And you'll hear that at a certain point. We kind of come out of the reverie that we've been in together and just recognize what's been happening between us and through us. It's really remarkable. So Robert is perhaps not as well known as his colleagues Thomas More and James Hillman, but I think has in his own way been as influential in certain circles. So let me read his bio, which I got and revised from the James Hillman Symposium website, where he's been a presenter a number of times. Robert Sardello, Ph.D., is co-founder and co-director of the School of Spiritual Psychology, which began in 1992. He's the author of many books on the power of soul and our relationship with the earth, and has been a practicing psychotherapist for over 40 years. His main emphasis has been to develop theoretical and practical approaches to perceiving and being in right relation with the soul of the world, showing that humans are pulled from the time stream from the future rather than pushed from the past, and developing the interior consciousness of the heart. He has created new yet very practical cultural visions in areas such as the meaning of books, the essence of service, the virtues, money, business, giving, healing, religion, living through the heart, and how to be in right relationship with and in the earth. And in our conversation, Robert and I touch on a number of these topics, but particularly on heart awareness, relationship with soul and the earth, and the soul of the world. But we go deep into some other areas that I haven't really touched on too much in the course of the podcast. We talk about the nature of evil, and Robert talks about the at least four types of evil, I think derived from the work of Rudolf Steiner. And, well, I don't know what else to say. I should just be quiet and let you listen. But I'd recommend really listening to the podcast in a way where you can give it your attention. So when you're relaxed, lying or sitting somewhere comfortable, maybe somewhere in nature where you can just gaze at the trees or clouds or water as you listen to this conversation. And toward the end of the conversation, I asked Robert to lead us in a meditation into heart awareness. And so that will require your presence. And I don't know what else to say. You might hear our senior Boston Terrier, Kingston, in the background during this conversation. As per usual, he's lying beside me as I talk over Zoom, whether it's with a client or a podcast guest, and you might hear him snoring. And at a certain point, he asks to get out of the room, so he's whining, and I have to pause and let him out. And then at another point, he's crying at the door to come back in. So you might hear some of that, and I hope it just adds to the kind of naturalness and humanness of this conversation. We got really real in this conversation, and man, Robert is just such a wise man and someone that certainly speaks from a deep spiritual experience. You'll hear that. So please sit back, lie back, relax, and enjoy this conversation with Robert Sardello on the Medicine Path. I'm here with Robert Sardello. And Robert, I really want to thank you for taking the time to meet with me and to record this conversation for our listeners.
I'm very, very pleased to meet you and looking forward to our conversation after listening to a number of past conversations. Poses a great challenge.
Well, I like to really just kind of go with the flow. And I have to confess, I'm always a bit unsure of how to get the ball rolling with these conversations, especially with someone like yourself, who's had such a long and rich career and whose work I'm actually just starting to explore and get into. And like I mentioned in email, it was Thomas Moore who kind of turned me toward your work. And when I found your book, Heartfulness, I knew that this was a guy I have to explore more deeply, because I had a
profound heart awakening about 12 or 13 years ago during my midlife wake-up call. It was like a reawakening to my heart and soul. And I've been kind of on this journey ever since to explore the mystery of the heart and to try to understand, maybe isn't the right word, but exploring why or how it's been so transformational to me. And it's a very difficult thing to talk about. And the closest I've ever found is in the poetry of Rumi and maybe someone like John Keats. Or, you know, the poets speak the language of the heart and music to me, wordless music even. But your book also, I think I could sense there is a struggle to try to describe the experience of the heart. And you even created kind of your own new language around it.
The difference between conceptual thinking and the realm of feeling, not emotion at all, but feeling, which is the realm of the heart, because that's really two different time streams. Conceptual thinking is really concerned ultimately with truth, searching for truth. And that comes in a lineage from the past. You know, what somebody else wrote, somebody else said, I'm taking it up in this way. So that's a time stream from the past. But feeling, which is what the very word means, feeling is touch. It's knowing as if you're intimately in touch with the actuality rather than the distance of conceptualizing. But that has to do with the time stream from the future. There's a time stream that of the not yet that is arriving, but you can't know it because it hasn't been here before. But you can, the heart can feel it. The heart can feel the presence of the emerging. And I got interested in that because of psychology is so concerned with the past, which always seems strange to me, of people coming into a session of therapy and they want to be different. And we start saying, well, tell me all about your past. And so you know, the moment that's done, it's kind of stuck. It's going to be that. And rather than let's see, rather than what pushes you around from the past, what is pulling you from the future? Let's be so much more interested in people's becoming rather than what they bring that kind of holds that back. So that's one. And then the way of hearing that has to be through the heart. Can't be just conceptual hearing, because then it'll be somebody talking about themselves rather than from within their very being. And we're together in an acoustical space that reconfigures itself as it's doing right now. I mean, the particular words are not first, it's the acoustical space that then momentarily configures into these words, then dissolves, and we're in this non-dual realm in the heart.
And yet in that space, there's still an impression of what just happened, maybe, or even associations to the past. Like your words, they land, they make an impression and then provoke often a response from the listener or me.
Yeah, that's the question of how to stay in the heart. And maybe we can get to that. I don't know if this will be helpful, because I do want to try to say something about it, because psychology is the problem, and that has to be addressed. Psyche is not the problem. Psychology is the problem, in the sense that, you know, The word psychology that came about in the 1600s, 1669 or so, and it was a word invented by a man named Melanchthon, who was an associate, a friend of Martin Luther. So when Martin Luther broke from the church, in a way, that opened up the soul in a new way. But what Melanchthon did is he named that opening up, he says, that we'll call psychology. So but that removed psyche from the world, and it made this special place that we now think of as a certain kind of interiority, and it removed soul from the world. And it replaced, and Melanchthon was also he was really the first economist. So the soul of the world is replaced by money. And so that I think that the real work of psychology is returning soul to the world. I don't think of myself so much as a psychologist as much as a practitioner of the soul of the world.
Is it possible for the world to lose its soul? Like, is it for us? Is it up to us to give soul back to the world?
It is now. It's been, over millennia, many, 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 all of the larger spiritual realms, that includes soul, they're being handed over to us gradually, but you have to think really, really long. And, now the church is nearly gone. So that's a kind of final handing over. We have to do that ourselves now. And it's a real difficult because it can be lost. Right now, the world, as you know, is at a very, very crucial initiation moment where everything is crumbling, everything, partly because it is old and corrupted, completely corrupted. But it's also just there is this opening that is happening, and the question is, how is that going to be filled? It's not going to remain a void. And there are really, really strong forces trying to take advantage of that, develop primarily technologies for the complete control of the human being, which once we see that happening, the awakening of the inner life and the heart, that is the creative realm of the human being, becomes the absolute necessary way of meeting this other danger of being humans being completely controlled. I think you feel that that's where we are, and that's where what I try to do is situated in that location.
So psychology having something to do with objectifying the soul in order to study it from a kind of empirical distance?
Either objectifying it, which is
reducing it down to mind or something.
Or going the other way and entering it in such a way that it is disembodied.
Some supernatural element.
Either supernatural or conceiving of the soul as not embodied. I mean, that's the work, at least as I feel his work, is how to be a soul presence that is a soul that is simultaneously body, soul, spirit, earth. within conscious awareness. That's the, when I speak of the soul of the world, that's what I mean, partly. Partly, the other part is that is done, that can be done, that can be met from the place of the heart, which takes us into total non-dualism. And because from the heart, when we're within the heart, others in the world are not, they're not separate realms. It's not all mushed together either. It's a complex unity. And then how to meet that and become, well, it's this kind of work then has to do more with developing a different way of living rather than I live my life in the world and then I have also as one of those world concerns, my concern happens to be psychology. It's not, this is different than that. It really is seeing that we're in a time when a whole new recreating can happen, or alternately, a completely new form of total control will happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think it's being hyperbolic to say that. I mean, I've said this to clients more and more, is that I really believe that we're in a battle for our souls.
Yeah.
You know, battle with technology or consumerism or capitalism, you know, all these kind of forces that I think have a common energy or presence or being behind them. They're just certain manifestations of something which is evil. I don't know how else to put it.
Yeah, but evil's a necessity. It's not a evil.
Well, it gives us something to wake up to and to then start to fight for, right?
Well, it's also the only way that new capacities can come about by, it's not so much fighting in the sense of we've got to, you know, somehow
destroy it. Mm-hmm.
But always being awakening more and more so that we don't unconsciously get taken over as much of the world is. I mean, and meaning that it is now, it's unbelievably a materialistic world. That happened all quite unconsciously. An invasion by greed and, you know, and possession and all of that kind of.
Yeah. There's something else kind of emerging too. It's almost like, I've never thought of it this way, but it just came up as you were talking, that seems like we're entering into maybe something like a post-materialist world where everything is becoming virtual. There's a real boom now of what are called NFTs. They're digital pieces of art that people are making enormous amounts of money off of something that's completely intangible and ephemeral. And I mean, so many of our interactions now are happening in this flatland of Zoom and watching YouTube videos.
That's the other, it's all accompanies this technology. And then this one's the worst, the most difficult, because we're becoming disembodied. Mm-hmm. And really to think about what that means, what it means, for example, here we are, we're doing it, we're having to, it has to be met, but here we are on the screen and recording, and this will be, you know, once it's recorded, it's not going to go away. I don't know where it goes, but I don't think they ever just erase them. It doesn't go away. But I'm going to go away. I will go away shortly, probably. Then what happens when I'm not here, but all those images and screen and that is now has no connection whatsoever with a living being?
Mm-hmm.
they can be that is a ripe place for the invasion of certain kinds of not so helpful forces.
Yeah, you hesitate to use the word evil.
Yes, because first that there's at least four kinds of evil, and like Lucifer, who is also the light, but and Luciferic evil is living in fantasy, I always live in a kind of fantasy, but that's redeemed by the making of beauty. Beauty redeems the Luciferic. The kind of evil that we're talking about, particularly technology and control, is called Ahrimanic evil. Ahriman.
Right. This comes from Rudolf Steiner?
From Steiner's work, yeah. And it's the kind of evil that works through knowledge, through conceptual trickery. Like technology and what technology can do and so on. But that has to equally be met. But it's met through fullness of knowledge rather than, narrow.
Right, so a knowledge that includes natural processes.
And soul, and
like knowing through the body, through the heart, other forms of knowledge, yeah. Just curious, Luciferic, Ahrimanic, what are the other two forms of evil?
And there's the Asuras. And the Asuras are those forms of evil that seek out destruction just for the sake of destruction. No other reason. Like mass shootings, those kind of that. They don't have any. And then the last one is called Sorot, who is kind of the most evil, and I really don't know how that shows up.
I wonder if that was what inspired Tolkien's Sauron.
Yes, absolutely, without question, yes.
So when we're talking about things becoming more ephemeric, virtual, intangible, is that more of the Luciferic kind of force at work there to get us completely caught up in this not so real world?
All of these modes of evil work together. Maybe an emphasis particularly like this mode in medium is very, you can feel the relation of Luciferic, Ahrimanic.
Yeah, right. Definitely. There's all of this, what we're doing is all caught up in the economy and attainment of material wealth and things like that. Yeah.
But it's also entertainment. In fact, all entertainment has that difficulty, all movies and so on.
It's like capturing our attention, which is such a valuable commodity.
Oh, great. Now that's a good place to kind of move in so we can show how to actually be heart present. And it concerns attention. What is attention for someone? It's not the same as paying attention. If I say pay attention, I remain here. If I say pay attention to your big toe, it's as if I'm over here and your big toe's over there, and I notice it over there. That's paying attention. Being attention is if I place my attention at the place of the big toe, rather than stay here, I place my attention there, then perception and sensing opens up in that moment as a kind of a big toe world. We see as if in the place of the big toe.
Yeah.
But that's the gift, is that attention is really another word for our individual spirit. So it can go anywhere. Mm-hmm. It can be anywhere. And so we can ask it to be in the heart, for example, or we can develop a process utilizing attention in this manner that will take us literally into the realm of the heart. And that's different than, again, speaking about heart, or, you know, he's a heartful person, you know, those kinds of, this is
more. First of all, I love that distinction between the paying attention and the being attention. Mm-hmm. Paying attention sounds to me like I kind of expect something in return too. Like, I pay attention to my big toe. What's my big toe going to give me? It's going to tell me something about big toes, or.
That's right.
And then being in toe space, it's more, feels like a move maybe from taking in kind of external information through my eyes and processing it through my brain with all its associations and judgments about, oh, I really need to give my toe some aesthetic love and all that, to being inside the toe. And it's more of a felt sense that is impossible to kind of speak about or conceptualize, because, I don't know, you'd have to learn toe language or something.
Yeah, or you have to do the phenomenology of toe awareness. And and you're right, there is no gain from it. And that'll become even stronger with the heartfulness, with being heart aware. There's no gain, because that concerns love. And we don't gain anything from love. But it's often put into getting something from it, which is then using love out of another consciousness. But love itself is about love. Deepening, widening, evermore, it just continues. Then it becomes a way, not something. It's a way of being.
Mm-hmm. Being in love.
Being in love. That's exactly.
I just, before we go into experiencing heart awareness, I mean, you write about this in that book, Heartfulness, that often it's an either or proposition with how we conceptualize or think of the heart, that it's often a substance without metaphor, or a metaphor without substance. And it's really hard for us modern folks to hold both realities at the same time. Can you speak a little bit about that?
Yeah. By the way, that book was written in, I think, 2007. So the work has exploded since then, and I'm just now writing two books that will be quite where that has gone since then. But because the heart is such an extraordinary organ that it is simultaneously physical, soul, and spiritual. The only organ that has those qualities. Because it's about inner space, it's about circulation, you know. But the heart is not a pump. That is not just a physical thing that shoves blood around the body. Because the blood ultimately, which comes through the capillaries to right to the surface of the skin, means that the movement of the blood through the heart is in relation, although it's a different periodicity, it's in relation to the movement of the sun. The movement of the blood through the body is part of the rhythm of the movement of the sun through the sky.
Mm, going out, returning, yeah. renewing every yeah. cycle.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's all. That's why the sun has always been connected with the heart. The,
right.
Yeah.
Well, it's also the source of life. I think the heart is the first organ to develop in the embryo.
Yeah.
Without the sun, we wouldn't be alive. Without yeah. the heart, we right. wouldn't be alive unless you're Dick Cheney and have a robot pump installed.
Well, that's right. It's just as the sun is the center of at least the Earth cosmos, not the Earth cosmos, so is the heart. The heart is this, even those, the word itself says that. The word is an anagram. Earth, take the H at the end, put it at the beginning, and it says heart.
I've never seen that before. Well, yeah.
So they're in that kind of rhythm together, heart, mm-hmm. and it immediately also reveals that Earth is a mode of consciousness, and when we're within the heart, that becomes absolutely apparent. Absolutely apparent that everything indeed is conscious, and but not necessarily conceptually conscious or anything like that. And
yeah, I also think about the heart, like you're talking about it being an inner space, but I also think about it as the place where we connect, when we connect deeply, like when we get beyond concepts and objectifying, true connection for me feels like it happens at that heart level.
Yeah, it's better, I probably would be more accurate to speak of innerness rather than the inner. Mm. And because it also begins to reveal that there is everything is innerness, everything. Meaning that what I perceive as a tree or birds or a room, that's congealed subjectivity. Just like, like we take the body is congealed subjectivity. So I take it as if it's an object, but it's congealed subjectivity. That's easy to show. I mean, if we take a deep breath, so that's just relaxing. But the word relax means de-densifying. De-densifying. So when we do take a deep breath like that, you feel a tingling at the periphery of the body.
De-densifying, like when you take a laxative, it softens, it allows for movement and flow.
Well, that's an interesting analogy.
Well, wouldn't it be the same root? Lax?
Yeah. Oh, yes. Very good. That's really cool. Yeah, that's right. But then already we begin to notice, oh, our body does not end at where my corporeal being ends. It doesn't stop there. That's the congealing of, you know, that there, I can, this that I feel here, that's also body. It's also body. But that's why I prefer this word. This is the process of the process of bodying, rather than saying I have a body. The moment I say I have a body, I've congealed it even further with a concept.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So when you say the body doesn't end here, the surface level of my skin, or maybe the length of my hair would be the most I could imagine it extending. What do you mean by that?
Well, just with that little breathing that we did, and you feel the tingling, and if you place attention there, it will be as if there is a field here, or a field is opening, a light, a kind of a radiance that is there, and I don't have the with my eyes and with my, it's more immediately sensed even. I can't see it particularly. Mm. But I don't know where that ends.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't want it, but that's not body.
Mm-hmm. Right, not a dense body in terms of the way we think about body.
Yeah.
But I think what you're talking about is the sense we have of a field surrounding the body, a field of awareness.
Yeah.
And where does it end? Yeah, it's hard to, you know, like some yogic texts say it ends 6 inches from the surface of the skin. But why? How so precise? I don't. Maybe they could see it. I don't know.
I don't know. And then plus, this is Hillmanian. It's really Jim. You know, that really alerted us to this. That soul is not in us. We are in soul.
Yeah, I quoted that recently. Now, could you explain that for Jim, who's not here, but who is an old friend of yours, I think? Yeah.
Well, it's just that, that it's not something inside us. And beyond this felt sense of the bodying, there's another encompassing field that is soul. That is soul. And our experiences from the past, and even the deep past and the archetypal past, they are really within that realm. Jung called it fantasy, but he didn't mean fantasy at all. I mean, he meant imagination, but he meant it even more than that. He meant this realm that was, oh, he didn't talk that way, but he meant it, you know, it was surrounding us. We are in it. And it's a field or a, it's a living, intangible, I want to call it invisible, but here invisible as also being in the visible. Not suddenly, and it does relate to our past in those deep ways, but it also relates to this question of the soul of the world and experiencing it, because if we're in it, it doesn't mean it doesn't mean that we each carry our own little field and it only goes so far, and we're still actually, you know, totally separate, but we now are separated with little an array of fields. When we start to move here, suddenly we are all in constant creating, being created, relating.
Mm-hmm.
Not only with each other, but with the world and the cosmos and beyond the cosmos, into the soul world and the spiritual world. Well, it just is, that is, sounds probably abstract, but it actually really, really felt. And imagine living with that sensibility.
Mm. Well, I wonder, my experience of the soul, and I'm not alone in this, is that we do have an individual soul that carries with it certain characteristics.
Yeah.
So how could we all be of the same soul and still have that sense that, is that a construct of the ego that wants to have an individual soul that's unique?
There is true individuality, but that's really the spirit coming through the soul and radiating completely through the soul, through the etheric, even into the physical. And we do, of course, in that sense, it's the personality. But that takes us into, So it's really the spirit. But think of, see, what does it, what does I mean? When we say I, as we're saying, well, I think this, or excuse me, I have to leave for a moment. Because that sense of the I is so congealed, that's very difficult to get to feel personality as beyond its individual, but it is at the same time beyond that. Because, and that's because there are actually three eyes. There's not just the eye, there's three eyes.
Yeah, I was going to say, it depends on which eye you're referring to. Yeah, go ahead.
So this eye is the empirical eye. You know, I'm sitting here and we are talking and I hear you, and that's the empirical eye. And it's not as, again, they're not separate. They're all, but then there's a separate quality or different form of I that is more, it's called the philosophical I. That's the one that says, oh, let's see, what you said was really, really interesting. I need to really hold that for a while and kind of ponder it and let it work. That's not the empirical I. That's another I. But, you know, they're in relation. And then, but then there is the spiritual I. That's the one, the spiritual I that we can actually feel the incoming force from this field that is as if it is a force that comes down through the interior central core of our being, down to our toes. That's the divine eye. And it's met immediately by a felt sense of a force moving up through the feet, through the central core of our being. These two forces meet at the place of the heart, so that the verticality now moves simultaneously this way and this way, and that we can be in that together. That's kind of the description.
Yeah, I always thought of Christ on the cross as being a beautiful description of that, the meeting of above and below, and then the horizontal plane of the radiating out and the circulating force.
Yeah. Interestingly, the Templar cross has three bars.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm positive that they knew about the three eyes.
I was involved with the kind of syncretic esoteric church from Brazil for a few years, and they had two bars on the cross, a smaller one above the typical horizontal, and much like what an Orthodox cross looks like, but I don't know how the Orthodox Russians, for instance, how they think of that, but in this tradition they talked about that second bar representing the second coming of Christ, which was to happen in the hearts of all humankind.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm. Well, it's true in a way, even if you think of the three eyes, where that will be felt is in that middle eye, as the union of the divine and the bodily meeting in this central place. It's kind of like that.
Mm.
Symbolically. Feels.
Okay. Yeah. I'm curious. When did you awaken to the heart and awaken to the mystery of it? And was it an experience, or was it someone like Corbin, his writing about the heart or thought of the heart? What was it?
No, it was dissatisfaction.
Perfect. Me too.
I mean, just not, you know, I mean, I went into psychology. I really did, because what the word says, the logos of the soul, the speech of the soul. So I went to graduate school expecting, oh boy, we're going to learn about the soul.
This would be like some kind of mystery school.
Yeah, I really thought it would be. I almost got thrown out of graduate school 5 times for asking him about the soul. Just in a class saying, well, yeah, but can you say anything about the soul? Because I really would push that. And so psychology, that kind of psychology just was, I mean, I barely got through. And I didn't realize at the time how much that was going to take to shed after. But I did know enough where I went to teach at Duquesne University after that in Pittsburgh, which is the only university in the world that has a program in phenomenological psychology.
Oh, wow. Really?
Phenomenological psychology. So that's the other, everything that I now do is based in phenomenological description, which means just like it, it's the logos of phenomena. The speech means that we try to listen and allow any phenomena to speak for itself rather than imposing some kind of a theory or a structure or
interpretation.
Let it reveal itself. And that's how I got to the heart. And just stumbled. I mean, just not, you know, moving from Duquesne to the University of Dallas, where I was able to start a program in phenomenological psychology all the way through the PhD degree. So
is this back in the 60s or 70s?
70s, yeah. 70s through the 80s. But it's more, I don't know how much to go into it. It's just that then gradually, I would say, stumbled into the heart. I was never comfortable with the notion of psychology being so humanocentric, completely humanocentric, which then leaves the world and earth devoid. And then we go around feeling, even if I do depth psychology, feels like, well, there's where soul is, but what about the world? And I've always felt that. So it more than naturally, pretty naturally unfolded from someplace beginning to, the moment the heart is actually experienced, it's immediately apparent that it is one with the complexity of Earth. It's just a given. So it wasn't even having to find it. It's just given.
Yeah. I just need to let this dog out. He's ready to go.
Okay. Chris, thank you. Give me a moment too to what comes is again about this conceptual and feeling realm, and particularly in trying to convey that in writing, because it does then turn out to be an intertwining of concept and feeling. So that, I'm sure that it confuses people. They either get it right away, or they say, I haven't got a clue of what you're talking about, because it doesn't fit.
And so challenging.
Yeah.
Sorry, just to jump in there, but it's in engaging in the mystery, the wondering about the heart, feeling how transformative it's been in my life. And trying to help people awaken to that. Like for me, it was like, I wasn't looking for it. It was like an act of grace or something. It happened. It's happening.
Can you say in a little bit how that occurred?
Well, I was in my mid-30s and had quite a successful career as a graphic designer in advertising and found myself at a place of real great suffering and dissatisfaction. And stress and anxiety were just increasing, and sleepless nights and nightmares and panic attacks, and soul was crying out. I can look back and see that now. And so I went searching for help and found my way into some strange corners of the world, like with this Brazilian church that uses ayahuasca as a sacrament. And I didn't know much about it when I got into it, but the first ceremony that we had, I experienced a profound death and rebirth. And I felt like I had come, the way I describe it is coming home to my heart. And I remember walking out and looking up to the night sky and just kind of being in love with the world again, like I was when I was a little kid. And it's been a constant source of renewal ever since. And so always kind of seeking, like, who else is talking about this? Like, who gets this? Help me understand this, because I didn't hear about it in religion class or in Sunday school. I didn't read about it in psychology, which was mostly seemed how to change your behavior or to understand your past and how it's affected you. And but where was the heart? Where was the soul? And I mean, this is the course of study I've been on for the past 12 years or so, you know.
In your description, I'm pretty sure this always happens, that it requires, the awakening requires going through some kind of death. Either, and I don't mean literally, but it can be literal as a death experience, but some kind of something you're completely removed from what you were, as you described. That is almost, it because it cannot, heart cannot be added on to the way we already are. I have all this and I want heart too. You can't. It's a complete revolution.
That's interesting. I've never heard that before, actually. But that's what happened. I mean, I had an experience where from mind's perspective, ego perspective, I lost consciousness. Although I don't think I lost consciousness. I think just the ego got kicked out of the room for a while. And when I woke, I mean, it was like a rebirth and a homecoming. And, you know, I looked at the group and they're welcoming me back in, and I felt like I belonged somewhere for the first time and maybe forever. It was remarkable. But yeah,
I'm wondering certainly how you retained that and developed it and continued it, because many people do that. They do have that revelatory experience, but then get caught up again into the usual collective consciousness.
Well, I upturned my life. I mean, I quit my successful high-paying job within a month. We sold our house in Toronto and we moved out to the West Coast, to where I'd always kind of felt at home in the nature here. And, you know, it's been a financial struggle ever since, but I've never felt more satisfied, more alive, more kind of in wonder, more in love with life. You know, maybe not so much in love with the way the world's gone. That's been the biggest struggle for me.
Yeah, that's really, really helpful, because it gives a wonderful kind of picture of heartful presence as a way of life. But it requires a moment of absolute commitment, whether it's even voiced or known, but there's something that occurred for you. And that's the difference of, say, people who have such experiences and are really awakened in the heart. They don't very often follow it through so carefully as you did with an actual commitment. Because you were basically saying, look, I'll do anything, whatever, to stay within this and watch it unfold in development. Nothing is going to remove that. That's a commitment.
Yeah, it's a sacrifice, but it feels like it's the most important thing. to me. Because not having kids, I wonder why else would I be here if not for witnessing, participating in this, and then trying to bring that into the world somehow, because I'm in such despair over how the world is going.
Yes. You know, the word sacrifice means to make holy, but both holy and holy. And to make holy means, you know, everything that I think I can have is not to be had. It's not a matter of having it. It's a it's a different way of doing.
And yeah, that rings true to me. Like, I think some of what I've been responding to is sensing an absence of soulfulness, heartfulness in our culture, and trying to give something back into that to help keep it alive in the world. Because if it's lost, I think we're completely lost. I think it's we're at a crucial point now where if we don't revive the heart and soul, we're done with. There's no hope.
Yeah, I was thinking that way too, but I've given up that way of thinking. Meaning that no matter what, the work is to stay and remain within heart. Doesn't matter in a certain way what goes on. It's just as, isn't this interesting? It's a whole new situation to now develop even probably more deeper and wider and higher heart awareness. So otherwise it's too hard. I get caught in this is the end kind of phenomena. It is the end of an era and the beginning of another era. And either way, even if it goes well, it's a new work that is, and not just new creative, absolutely creative.
I don't so much despair like the end of our civilization or even of humanity, to be quite honest. I don't think that's such a big deal. But what I do despair over is the suffering that I see, the kind of sense of lack and loss in the people that come to me, and people I meet, you know, in everyday life. And I just know that life can be so much richer and that we can be in such deeper relatedness with the world and with each other that can bring so much joy and help to not alleviate suffering, but to help us bear it.
That's why you're doing what you're doing. It's hard work. I mean, the relation between suffering and heartfulness or like that. Heart being within heart is a suffering, meaning I allow, I receive rather than think that I'm controlling. Mm-hmm. And so people who suffer, they're right at the doorway. That is the doorway, for sure.
My yoga teacher, TKV Desikachar, he got well known to the West for a book called The Heart of Yoga. And his yoga was all about awakening people to the heart. And he said, you know, thank God for my suffering because it brought me to yoga, which then became his life. And
What
an attitude. Thank God for my suffering. Why? Yeah. Because it helped me to awaken.
Psychology used to do that. I mean, it really did used to do that. And in some ways, it, I'm not sure that it does now. If there's not an invasion in psychology by this will make you better and we'll take away that and things will clear up. That's not psychology anyway. It is, the difficulty is your suffering is not filled with consciousness of what is going on and how to move within it. And the only way to do that really is within the realm of the heart.
Mm-hmm. Because it's the lack of consciousness of the suffering that creates the internal rift.
Yeah.
Because suffering's happening. And we're trying to do everything we can to not experience it. And it's actually the rift that is creating the problems, maybe, more so than the suffering itself.
Oh, yeah. And you'll always, I'm sure you've noticed this, every time you're about to make some kind of a inner move, not knowing it at all, but things will get worse. Your life will get worse. It'll not be good. But that is the, it's just saying you're ready now to go to a different level within the heart. And once that happens, that particular way of just being caught in suffering is dissolved. That was, by the way, in a way, again, you already know I don't believe in psychology per se.
I'm getting the sense of that. You sound very much like Hillman in that respect.
And I also don't believe in therapy in the usual sense. Because once those times of suffering can be seen as this is where there is the moment of developing a new deepening heart capacities. But then it has to be done, has to, you know, have to really work at that. I do consulting with people. I don't call it therapy because it's not therapy. I consult with them concerning heart. And people who would be often typically, you know, sort of categorized as needing therapy for this or that, anxiety, depression, all that, I don't go anything into the usual way, but just we practice heart engagement together. Without exception, whatever any of those people came in with, that dissolves. I mean, it dissolves by becoming inwardly held and worked with within the heart. And so it's a different, I don't want to call it therapy.
Well, like, you know, one of my mentors, Tom Moore, he really stresses that what we're doing when we're doing psychology is soul tending or caring for the soul, which to me is much different than talking about the past. Like, yeah. You know, I remember reading Hillman once saying, you know, I'm not interested in origin stories.
That's right. You know, there are those people, Hillman and Moore, and they're doing something quite different too. That's true. Yeah,
I'm just sending my wife a message because the dog that I just let out is now crying to come back in the room. So, well, you know, that's very interesting to me because that's been, I think, you know, I've been counseling people for, you know, 5 or 6 years. It kind of grew out of the yoga teaching that I was doing because I was teaching people individually, helping them to develop a personal practice. And often they would bring, you know, problems that they're experiencing in their life to our sessions. And we end up talking more than we ended up practicing yoga. And so I wanted to meet people where they were and what they were bringing to the sessions. And so I started to study more and get some trainings and try to find an approach that felt resonant with the approach to yoga that I'd been taught, which was very much this heart-centeredness and not so prescriptive or not about attainment or anything like that, but really bringing ourselves into heart awareness. Like Deshkachar always said, yoga is about relationship. The quality of your relationships reflects the quality of your practice.
Well, you're doing love, which is what we are, doing what human beings are here to do. Not just to do, not as if, well, we're this way and then we do that. There is no, our doing is our being. Our doing is our being. That is, the human being is a being of love here to do love. But then what is love? Love then is, as you mentioned in terms of counseling or therapy, love is undivided attention. Undivided attention. Mm-hmm. Undivided.
Yeah. Well, I guess where, you know, why I was mentioning that is that I've been somewhat frustrated when people come to me and they're so conditioned to want to talk about the past and want to talk about their childhood and identify the early traumas that are the cause for everything that's not going right in their life now. And my experience of it was getting into the heart. And like you said, all of those things that seemed like problems before, they dissolve.
They dissolve, or they're still there, but they don't have that sense of unbearableness.
Yeah. Like the space of the heart is so vast that all of those instances, those things that happen, seem so small in comparison. And the heart can hold all of it. And it's, yeah, you can visit it. You can be caught by one of those memories or past experiences, but you always have the opportunity to release back into the bigness of the heart.
I need to kind of go back a bit, and because it was for purposes of finding our way here. But, you know, all those other little things, all those other ways of even doing therapy and what people have to go through, and even the problematic solving therapy, that's all right too. I just don't want to include this as within that mode, but I don't want to say that it's not helpful either. It may turn out to be very helpful and make it possible for, you know, heartfulness. So I need to kind of go back on what I was.
Sure. Yeah. I appreciate that. So then, because that's, you know, where you've just chosen to focus, it's, you know, it's where you're coming from and where you want to help guide people. When someone comes to you and they're really caught up in their old story and they want to like get to the bottom of their big T trauma, how do you respond to that? You know, how do you kind of gently guide them toward the heart? And
Well, I don't, I mean, I just, whatever the phenomena is that it comes and it presents itself, listen from the place of the heart. And gradually that will become, because it's done in undivided attention, their attention becomes undivided, and that's, and it's, and it's gone. And I don't say that's fast. Sometimes that takes a long, long time. I want to mention, I'm noticing very interesting our conversation, because I noticed the background very strongly, not so much the objects, but there are moments in our conversation where you're emerging out of this space that you're in, including the background. It's not like, it doesn't even feel like you're in a room over there sitting in front of a wall with decorations. That's, I'm already, there were moments in which you are being reconfigured out of that realm of space that you were within. And it's quite lovely. Because it's the first time ever I've experienced it through this medium. So that is extremely helpful, because it gives hope to medium.
Mm.
Because this is in the current of electronic currents.
Mm.
And that's, thank you. I think it's remarkable. Mm.
Well, yeah, I've had to kind of exclusively meet with people over this medium for the past 2.5 years. And I was always familiar with it because I'd always worked with people who lived abroad, and, you know, so I was one of the first people actually on Zoom. I met one of the founders and he said, oh, you got to try out our platform. You think Skype is not so great? Well, we're working on this thing, right? So, but what I found, and I don't know. I always create a ritual when I open up this screen. I have a little altar here. I light a candle. I burn some incense. I say a little prayer. I have, my reminder of why I'm doing this. I have my heart here on my altar. But what I've found actually is that all of this, this computer that you seem to be living within and the distance just kind of can fade away if both of us are really present and open and listening and engaged. Everything else, I just noticed I have a window open with questions on it that I haven't even looked at because I've kind of been in your space, it feels like. Yeah. So everything else kind of blurs out and fades away. And I call that entering medicine space. And I don't know if it's like it for anyone else, but, I find it's possible through this medium somehow.
Yeah, that's Earth heart space, definitely. And to experience being within that in this medium is a revelation for sure.
Yeah, just like actually being together, even though we're so far apart,
Yeah. Thank you for saying how you have the room. It's not just I walk in and sit down at a chair and boom, you really are very aware of making a place where something can happen that has not happened before. That's what I most admire about what you do is how you can do it without it becoming, here it is, another one of these happening again. No, I'm sure that no one you've talked with has any sense that it was like that, because it's not at all. And
if it was going to be that, why bother? If I was just going to repeat some questions that the publisher sent me, I'm like, why? It's not worth me showing up for this. I'm not adding anything special to the world. I want to be here to explore with people like you. I don't want to just be another platform for you to deliver your monologue that you've delivered 100 times about this particular book or whatever, It's like, well, there's enough of that out there. So it takes two. It takes two to tango, because some people do show up and they've got their script and they're not really here. So thank you for being a part of it.
Takes two as one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm recognizing the time, Robert, and you've already been really generous, but I really would love to end with maybe something experiential for people who are listening. Could you offer us like a little guidance into, just tippy-toeing into the heart space or heart awareness? Is that possible?
Well, the first little tippy-toe, yes, because you'll notice it right away. If anybody thinks of a difficulty there within, a problem or concern and a feeling and anxiety, doesn't matter what it is. Whatever it is, just drop into quietness.
Well, I'm a little worried about, when I get my tax statement back, what it's going to say. So I'll sit with that.
Yeah. Well, this just completely let that drop into the heart. Really. And gone.
Yeah, it's almost like the worry about it. Well, who knows? It's like sploosh, and like in this present moment, everything's functioning. Here I am. I'm with someone who. Yeah. What an interesting, remarkable person! Like, wow, isn't life grand?
Well, even that, then you get interested in, I wonder if that can become permanent or at least more available all the time. And then we can go into I want to try to describe this little practice, because at one point it'll take you into something astounding, or at least we can talk about it. And that is, you start with that deep breath and relaxing, D de-densifying the body. And noticing the tingling at the periphery of the body. And then select a place at the periphery of the body, like your arm, your left arm. And you notice that kind of, it feels like you've been lightly touched. You're being lightly touched. So then you pour your attention, pour your very being into that place. Pour. And you'll feel like it's going through a tunnel of some sort, but it's revolving. And suddenly it gradually, it comes to a quietness, an inner quietness. And that is the place of the realm of the silence. Silence doesn't have to do with being quiet. It's a place. This is the place of silence. Deep. Feels like it's deep. Certainly inner. Inner deepness. Unending. You can't, within silence, you don't know where it is. You don't come to a wall that says, oh, that's the end of silence. Then you place silence attention into the silence. Pour it into the silence. And you feel another complete, it's like your whole body is being reconfigured. And you come to this place of, like, you come to the place of stillness, pure stillness, which is thousands of times more quiet than silence. And if we stayed with it, you'll even begin to see within this stillness that it is a like a velvety black realm that is not at all flat. As we just stay there, you notice that it's infinite. Sometimes even a lot of little points of light show up in it. But you can continue placing attention within the silence, and then again into the silence. That goes deeper and deeper and deeper. This is the realm of the spiritual worlds before initiation occurs. That is, with what we're doing, we won't meet likely spiritual presences and beings and like those who have died and angels and other presences of the spiritual worlds. That takes a whole other work. But it says, well, human beings are always in connection with the infinite realms. Now, within this infinite realm, with our lips, either silently or with saying, but it has to be done by also moving the body, the lips, we gesture the word "word." And another complete reconfiguring of our whole being occurs. And we are within heart, but heart has no particular boundaries. But it is still completely in body.
Mm-hmm.
And it's felt, can feel a force centered at the level of the heart, but toward the center of your being. And it's a radiance that moves way beyond the corporeal body, while at the same time, an inner equal radiance occurring. And now we are within heart. And that doesn't go away with our eyes open. It's still very, very present. And quite easy to stay there, stay within that place. It can become now a place of living, or although it needs to be renewed, the little breath needs to be renewed, but it's it is now very present.
Mm. Yeah, I had this image of a little man, like little I, going into a bathysphere and just dropping down into this vast dark ocean with phosphorescent creatures flitting around. You're talking about those lights in the space and being in the silence inside the silence, like the silence of this little bathysphere inside the greater silence of that substantive silence.
Really good.
I can just have an image now that, you know, if I feel like I'm getting caught up in something, I can put that little man in the bathysphere and just droop.
That was very, very interesting, you know. And it's very remarkable because particularly that place of coming into that stillness and how even now it feels that we are a continuity unfolding from forever. We're not alone, and it's not, I mean, even in everyone who has ever lived is here right now.
Yeah, when you're talking about it being difficult to feel or describe the shape of the soul, you know, for the first time I had the image of my soul being stretched back into time.
Yes.
So traveling like through dimension. Another dimension is, you know, as well as not having some form I could put my finger on.
Yeah, great. Hmm. You're very, very good at describing, and that's very helpful. It's helpful. Hmm. It's helpful for you because it helps you.
Got the image now, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Also, enormously helpful for anybody. I mean, hearing you, it gives an orientation that. That's why I think maybe I mentioned this, but exercises and spiritualities are full of exercises and practices. I want to revision exercise because it doesn't mean if I work at this, then I develop something that wasn't there before.
Right, so, like I'm building my heart muscle.
Right. But it is the artistic activity of making and being at the same time and being within an image. It's the work of art of integral spiritual psychology. The work of art is the practices.
Mm.
completely changes the sense of practice.
Yeah, that's great. You know, after I had some really good teaching in yoga, like how to really practice yoga and to find my own practice or find the practice that wanted to find me or something, because it felt like an act of discovery every day, showing up and seeing, okay, what does yoga want to do with me or something? But I would often have these images, and it became really clear to me early on that everything that we know in the yoga scriptures was just these practitioners trying to describe something of their experience so that it could be shared with others. And there was nothing dogmatic about it, because if you look at all the different scriptures and all the descriptions of chakras and kundalini and all of this, there's no consensus. But of course there's no consensus, because we're talking about individuals having their unique experiences based on their own past experiences and culture and environment and everything else. And that gave me such a sense of freedom around my practice that, you know, it became clear to me that the technique was a way in to that kind of openness that allowed images and forms and mantras and all these other inspirations to come through, and that new things could be discovered that way. And that then yoga as a thing remains alive and like ever unfolding. So when you talk about the practice being images, that really brought something home for me.
Art, this whole art sense, and that too.
What else is in heart?
Well,
art.
Art, right, of course. There it is. We also have just moved, as we move from our usual ordinary consciousness, which is fine the way it is, but it's a shift from living according to fate to living in relation to destiny.
That's that past and future pull you're talking about. Yeah. Nice way to put it.
Yeah.
Say that again, please.
Well, the heart is when in the heart, you're in the realm of destiny rather than feeling fate. This is when you live from the past, you'll strongly feel that sense of fate. And it's there. I don't want to take it away. It's there. But in the absence of also feeling destiny, the most important part to say it is that, first, that destiny isn't something that you know.
Right. That's what I was thinking. It's always unknown.
Yes. Well, it's something you are, and you know you are within it.
You're becoming destiny.
Becoming it. Destiny is life as it now appears each moment. Plus, the way you'll notice when you're in destiny is, it'll show up not in here, but in the world, perceptually. So-called synchronicity is what Jung called it, but it's got a bad ring to it now.
Yeah.
It just means that we've also opened into world unfolding. So you'll see something like, you won't recognize it. After Jim Hillman died, I was sitting in my office and I felt his presence really strongly. And he said, go outside. And I thought, well, I'm not going to do that. I'm just making that up. Go outside. So I went outside and it was dusk, almost, and the moon was out. And then all of a sudden this we lived in front of a little lake, and a huge flock of geese flying in formation, just at that moment I was there, went through, and I knew, bodily, I knew Jim Hillman, Jim. There was no doubt about it. It didn't remind me of him. It wasn't symbolic of him. It was his presence. Those kind of occurrences will happen. that don't look like they're related to what I'm maybe struggling with at all, but they absolutely do and open the way to stay within what we're, you know, attempting to do that in terms of the heart and the opening, and not get caught in my, how am I going to solve that? It will be, it's revealed, it's shown in the world. Because the earth is the spiritual earth. See, I always wondered about heaven. Where in the hell is heaven?
Where in the hell is heaven? What a great sentence.
Yeah, we think of it as, I don't know, up there somewhere, man. But there is no, it's here.
It's above the clouds. Come on, that's where the angels hang out, Robert.
That's right. It's right here. This is heaven. No.
Well, that was like what Christ said. I mean, this is like, he just dropped that little truth bomb in there, though. I don't think enough has been made of that.
Yeah.
But he said, it's all here, like split open a piece of wood and I'm there, and, you know, lift up the rock and I'm there. And
right.
It's like, that to me suggests like the splitting open of the log or the lifting of the rock to find the kingdom of heaven suggests to me that, you know, it's normally, maybe not normally, but it's often hidden from our perception. And we got to kind of do a little digging around in order to see it.
Yeah. Yeah.
In all the dark places, like inside, underneath, right?
Mm-hmm.
Significant.
Yeah.
It's a great teaching there. Why don't the churches make more of that kind of thing? Because I think, you know, people these days would be quite receptive of that kind of teaching. Like it's really good. It's very descriptive. It's very awakens the imagination.
Yeah, there are a few who I know. Actually, I have a really dear friend who's a Monsignor Catholic priest, and who went through our little gathering the year long. Heart initiation course, and he does, that's what he does in his preaching completely.
Great. Did you do an interview with him that's on YouTube in Houston?
Yes. No, in Dallas, right?
Dallas. Yeah. Okay. I'll post a link to that. I just started watching that this morning, actually, and I'm really intrigued.
Yeah. Good. Yeah.
Yeah. So if people want more Robert, I'll post a link there. And, you know, you started teaching online now. Is that right? You brought your school of integral psychology online?
I had to during pandemic. There's also three other YouTubes, though, that are conversations with
Pierce Kanuka?
Yeah. I have what's called the Heartful Soul Network. And it's by membership, and mainly because it's a place of work, you know, rather than people coming in and out. And it has postings and audios and videos, and we meet on Zoom to, there's a whole series of these practices, but we meet then every other week and do them together and all that kind of, it's all right, but you helped me. You helped really, really, really begin to redeem this medium. And I'm very, very, very grateful, and will really take some of what you said and showed that you do to make this space, you know, that it can happen in this space. Because it's been a year since that Heartful Soul Network, and I was toying with maybe I should stop because I'm worried about the medium. But I think... Mm. Thank you. I have a different way of considering it.
Hmm. Well, that's great. I think I might poke my head in the door.
I will send you a link.
Oh, that'd be great. Yeah. It's so hard to find spiritual community for me anyway. I found it so difficult. You know, I've tried out a bunch of different ones, and I don't feel quite at home in the modern yoga world. All the kind of psychology groups and things, I don't feel quite at home there. And like, I need to be in a place that puts the heart and soul front and center. And that's been so hard to find. So I'm so happy, first of all, that Tom Moore said, hey, check out this guy. And that you're still alive and you're still working and you're still... you're still offering what you offer. Like, my God, you know, it's been, I can't tell you how many times it's happened where I find out about someone and I read their work and it really resonates me and, oh, they're gone. You know, all I have is the books. So to have a living conversation with you, it makes me so happy. I feel so full.
Well, about finding a place, you know, you may well have to start it.
That's what my wife keeps telling me. It's in my astrology chart, apparently. I'm not much of an organizational type of guy.
Don't worry about that. That will show you how to do it. It will. You probably. Well, we'll see.
We'll see.
Listen, let it see. Try to hear it. I think I'm pretty sure you need to do that. Or called to do that.
Yeah, I've been sitting on a. You know how you buy domain names for websites?
Oh, yeah. Right.
I've been sitting on one for years for this imaginal gathering space. It's called the Heart Center.
Why didn't I think of that?
I already bought it.
Oh my gosh.
But imagine you know, heartcenter.ca, heartcenter.us, heartcenter.hungary, you know, heart centers all over the world.
Well, there you go.
And wouldn't that be something? We have a living elder here who's already created a body of work that could help guide us in this awakening of the world heart. My Lord, maybe we're onto something here, Robert.
It's where it has to go. I don't know if this is, it's us, but it's the moment that it's so clearly needed.
It's do or die.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thanks so much for all your work. And like I said, I'll be swinging by your online virtual school and poking my head in, and maybe I'll see you over there.
I am very, very happy to meet you. And thank you for the invitation. And been a wonderful talk, really.
Yeah, it's been great for me. Thanks so much, Robert.
Okay, take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
The Medicine Path is produced by Brian James on unceded Coast Salish territory, Vancouver Island, Canada. For more information, visit brianjames.ca. Music by Olive Artizzoni, aka Greenhouse. Join the Medicine Path tribe and gain early access to episodes and the full podcast archives at patreon.com/medicinepath. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall soft upon your fields. Until the next time we meet on the Medicine Path.